everyone, and welcome to Premiere Gal. If you've never used Premiere Pro before and you want to start using it, this video is for you. So let's get into it. To get Premiere Pro, first you need to sign up for an Adobe Creative Cloud account. If you're an individual, it costs $19.99 per month for Premiere Pro. But if you're a student or a teacher, you can get all Creative Cloud apps for $19.99. So after you register, download the Adobe Creative Cloud desktop app. And after it's downloaded, open it up and log in with your Adobe ID that you created online. And this is where you can install Premiere Pro on your desktop computer or any other apps that you have in your Adobe Creative Cloud plan. After Premiere Pro is downloaded, open up the Premiere Pro app. And here is where you'll be prompted to create your first project. So first, choose a name for your project and save the project file into a folder on your computer. Premiere Pro will default to your computer's Documents folder as the save location. But if you have a hard drive smaller than 500 gigabytes, I'd recommend getting a portable solid state drive because videos can take up a lot of space and solid state drives are much faster than external hard drives. And because it's portable, it means you can take your files with you if you travel and work. Also, it may seem obvious to say, but file organization is the most important part of editing. I actually use a folder system template for each project I do. I've included a link to download this template, which you can use in your projects and to follow along with this tutorial. There are three main folders in this template. I have 01 project files, which is where I save the Premiere Pro project and any other project files I work on for the project, like Photoshop or After Effects files. Then there is 02 media, which is where I store photos, videos, graphics, and music. And lastly, I have a folder here called 03 output, which is where I store all the exported versions of my video, which we will get to later on. So let's save the project into 01 project files into the Premiere Pro project folder. And so this is what Premiere Pro looks like. Down here is the project panel, and here is where you put all of your media files, your video, photos, music, and audio. And to the right is the timeline, where you can see and visualize all your files in time. And above that is where you can watch what is in your timeline. And to the left, there are a couple tabs. The first tab here, the source tab, is where you can preview clips from the project panel. And in the effects tab is where you can add effects and animation to your files. So now that we're inside of Premiere Pro, the first step is to import the media so you can start editing. In the media folder you downloaded from the project templates, I've included some stock video files that you can use in this tutorial. To import, all you have to do is drag this video folder into the project panel. That's it. But if you're importing, let's say, from an AVC HD camcorder, you first need to copy over the contents from the camcorder's card to your project folder. Then you can go to the media browser, which is near the project panel, and find the folder that you imported the card contents to. And then once you're in that folder, you can hit Command A on a Mac or Control A on a PC to highlight all the clips, and then you can right click and select import. And the project panel here is like your home base in Premiere Pro. It's where you can see all your media, the photos, the videos, everything that you've imported, and you can search for media using the search field. You can see here that we have the video clips from the video folder here, and if you double click on one of the video clips, it will appear in the source panel where you can preview it and play it back. You can also expand this project panel out to see all sorts of information, such as resolution, duration, frame rate, and much more. And you can also move the description column over so you can see it better next to the clips, and add reference notes so you can have more detail on the clip. You can also change it to the icon view so you can use a visual reference to identify your media and increase the size of the icon with the slider. Also, at the bottom of this panel, you can create new bins to organize your media, and you can click on the new item icon where you can create a whole lot more, such as adjustment layers, color mats, captions, and we won't get to all of these in this video, but we will get to sequences, which leads us to the next section on timelines. When you go to select the new item icon from the project panel and select sequence, it will open up a new sequence panel. And the sequence basically creates a timeline from which you can start building your video. There are tons of sequence presets to choose from, so be sure to select a preset that best matches the frame size and the frame rate of your footage. Since I use a DSLR, I'm going to select DSLR 1080p 30 frames per second. I have a whole playlist on how to customize and make specific sequences for social media platforms, including square sequences, which I'll link to below. So here I'm going to call it rough cut, but you can call it anything you like my first video. And after it's created, it will appear in your project panel here, and it will also open up as a timeline to the right. And it's called a timeline because of the time ruler at the top, which will help you see how long your video duration is and make edits. There's also a time code here on the left upper corner of the timeline that shows you where the playhead position is. And this here is the playhead, and as you move it, you will see that the time code changes here. And then to the left of the timeline is a toolbar with tools that can help you edit. So now let's play some video in the timeline. There are a couple ways to add clips to your timeline. Not one way is the correct way. So the first way that I used is to select a clip from the project panel and then just drag it into the timeline. You'll see that the top layer here is for video. There's video layer 1, 2, and 3. And below the middle line is for audio. So you can see there's also an audio layer 1, audio layer 2, and audio layer 3. You can add your video and audio files to any layer that you want. And if you add more than 3 tracks in your timeline, it'll automatically create a new layer, V4, V5, and so on for you. If for some reason only the audio layer is seen in the timeline, or the video layer is not seen and you can see the audio only, make sure that your audio and video source patching is turned on. And I actually have a full tutorial that's free already on what source patching is. So if you're having this issue and you want to learn about source patching, be sure to watch the video link in the description box below. So if your video has audio, it will automatically come with it. If you hit the space bar, it will play it, and you can see what is in your timeline from the program panel directly above. You can also de-link the audio from the video at any time. You can hit Ctrl-L on a PC or Command-L on a Mac to de-link them, and you can delete the audio track or the video track from each other if you like. Then you can use the Razor tool to cut a clip at any moment. Make sure to turn the Snap tool on, so that way when you move the playhead to the location to make a cut, the Razor tool will snap to the playhead and cut perfectly there. Once you make a cut, then you can select the portion of the clip that you do not want anymore and simply press the delete key to get rid of it. And of course, you can click and drag the clips to anywhere in the timeline as you like. The second way to add clips to the timeline is by first double-clicking on the clip from the project panel. And then from the source panel, you can scrub to the moment you want the clip to start and press I to mark in, and then scrub to the moment you want it to end and hit O to mark out. Then click anywhere on the video and drag it into the timeline. So once you use these methods to add multiple video clips into your timeline, you can also reduce the duration of clips in the timeline by setting the playhead as a cut point, and then you can click the end of the clip and roll it back in to meet the playhead so it shortens the clip, like so. You can also use the selection tool to draw a rectangular marquee around multiple clips at once in the timeline, and you can move them together. And if you ever need to increase the timeline size, just move the scroll bar at the bottom like so. So now on to the next step, which is adding effects and transitions to your clips in your timeline. If you right-click at the beginning or ends of clips or at any cut point, you will get a drop-down menu that will enable you to apply a default transition. And Premiere Pro's default transition is called a cross-dissolve, which if you add it to a clip, it will actually make the clip fade in or fade out. Let me play it back from the program panel here, and you can see that it dissolves from black to the full image. Now let's apply another cross dissolve to the last clip at the end, and click the end of the transition to drag it out to be longer or shorter in duration. You can also select the transition, and from the effects controls panel up in the upper left, you can control the duration of the transition as well. Once you're ready to start editing your first Premiere Pro project on your own, I'd recommend using assets from Envato Market. There's tons of music, sound effects, editing templates, and stock video that will help you complete your projects. If you go to the links in the description box below, it'll include some of my favorite templates and stock video that I use. There are, of course, lots of other transitions and effects you can apply. So when you go to the effects panel, you will see that there are many folders of effects. You can also search for effects. So let's say you wanted to add a wipe transition. Just search for wipe. And then once you find it, you can drag and drop the wipe transition between clips. And if you play it back, you can see that the video transitions to the next video with a left to right wipe in the program panel. If you select the transition, you can also reverse it to be right to left using the effects controls. And of course, make it faster by reducing the size of the transition. For effects, let's say you want to make a clip out of focus to in focus over time. You can search for a Gaussian blur and drop it on the clip. You will see that nothing happens. That's because you actually need to go to effects controls. And here you can find the effect and add blurriness, let's say 75. And then if you want it to change over time to be in focus, you have to use what is called keyframing. And keyframe is a way you create animation. You need to set a point A as a starting point of the animation and point B as the end point. So let's create our point A by clicking the stopwatch icon next to blurriness. And now just to the right, you can see that this created our first keyframe, point A. Now move the playhead forward, let's say about 1 second, and it can be however much you want. It doesn't have to be 1 second. And then to set our point B, do not click the stopwatch again. Instead, you need to change the value of the blurriness that you want to change it to. So let's change it back to 0. And when we do that, it will automatically create a keyframe at the playhead, and that is our point B. Now when we play it back, you can see it goes from blurry to focused over time from point A to point B. And basically, you just animated the blurriness to change value over time. You can apply this same keyframing method to any effect you apply to a clip as well. And you can apply keyframing to the motion controls up here at the top. And this leads us to motion. If you ever want to change the position, scale, rotation, or opacity of a clip in your timeline, you can do that here. And there are two ways to do it. One, you can hit this little rectangle icon here, and then you are free to move the clip in the program panel. And you can use the transforming bounding box here to scale it up or down. If you do not like this method, you can actually change the numerical values more precisely in the effects controls panel here. There is no correct way because it's all based on your personal preference. And of course, you can adjust the opacity here to make the clip transparent or not. To undo any changes you make here in the effects controls panel, just click on the reset button right here on the right. There are so many different effects that you can apply, and there's also effects that you can purchase. And if you look in my effects panel, you will see that I have a ton of effects that you may not have. And a lot of these effects I use in most of my videos, one of which is the film impact transitions. I have a full tutorial on how to use film impact transitions, and I've linked to it in the description box below. Next, what if you want to add text to your video? Click on the type tool from the toolbar and then click and type in the program panel and you create a text. You will see that a graphics layer was also added to the timeline. To edit the text further, you need to use what is called the Essential Graphics panel, which is a new addition to Premiere Pro as of April 2017. So first you need to go and select the selection tool and then go up to Window and select Essential Graphics to open up the panel. Alternatively, you can select a workspace here at the top, and in this case you would select Graphics to open up the Essential Graphics panel. So from the panel you can change the text font, and you can also use these alignment tools here to recenter the text horizontally and vertically so it's right in the center. I'd recommend clicking and moving the toolbar panel to be closer to the Essential Graphics panel so it's easier to access. And then when you click on the pen tool here in the toolbar and hold, you can see that there are other shapes to choose from. Let's select a rectangle and draw one in the program panel just by clicking and dragging. The default color is red, but you can remove this fill if you want by checking the box or changing the color by clicking the color box. And you can also add a stroke and adjust the width of that stroke as well. You can use the selection tool from the toolbar to move the shape around the program panel, but if you want it to be completely centered, I would recommend using these alignment tools. You can also select this new item icon from within the Essential Graphics panel to import clip layers, such as photos. You can also import movie files or logos like PNG files or .psd files. Let's add in the Premiere Gal logo. Then from the panel here, you can resize it manually by typing in a new value. And you can use the selection tool to move it into the place that you like. There is really so much you can do with the new Essential Graphics panel, and I have a full course on how to use the Essential Graphics panel to animate the layers, to make shapes respond to text size, and how to save them as motion graphics templates. So I'd encourage you to watch it, and I'll link to the full course below. If you want to alter the exposure, contrast, or the color of your video image, you can open up the Lumetri Color panel by going up to Window, Lumetri Color. In here you can perform basic correction to make adjustments to the images, such as the exposure, the contrast, the highlights, the blacks and whites, and much more. I have a full free tutorial on how to use the Lumetri Color panel with the Lumetri Scopes, which is another window you have to open that helps you read color and light through graphs. Definitely watch this so you can understand how color correction works in Premiere Pro. So after you add all the clips to your timeline, as well as the transitions and effects, you can export your video to share. To do so, go to File, Export, Media. And here in the export window, double click here and select a destination where it will be saved. In our case, I'd recommend saving it into the output folder from the template folder I gave you. As for file format, Premiere Pro makes it pretty easy with presets. For example, if you're sharing to a specific platform, it has presets for a variety of resolutions. Since I primarily use YouTube, I can choose YouTube 1080 because that is the size of our sequence we set up in the beginning of the tutorial. There's also a publish tab, so if you want to log in to the social platform you are publishing to, you can add a description and a title, and then Premiere Pro will auto-publish the video to the platform for you. Then at the bottom of the export window, you can export here to export using Premiere Pro. And so that's all there is to it to get started editing in Premiere Pro. And if you want to learn more on how to create more effects in Premiere Pro, you can watch more of my YouTube tutorials here on this channel for free. And if you want to master Premiere Pro Essential Sound and Essential Graphics, you can take my 2-hour courses at Pluralsight. Thanks again for watching, you guys, and I'll see you on Wednesday for my What's Wednesday video on what do camera lens hoods do, and on Friday for a Friday FX tutorial to learn how to create a cinematic look in your video. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you all very soon.